I think it is. There we go. I hear it coming on now. Okay. God bless you. I think I'm still having a little bit of rain up here. Okay, y'all get to put up with me tonight. Actually, let me kind of tell you the little backstory behind what I'm teaching tonight. You know how y'all want to read your Bible and then you get the numbers and go, that'd be a good place to stop, right? I feel like you need to get through it just like one of those Jewish rabbis, rock just so you can stay awake. Anyway, I'm, you know, reading along, a dutiful Christian, and I came upon Numbers 19, and I knew there was something in there because, you know, if you've ever really gotten somewhere with God, all of a sudden something just lights up, and I said, there's something to this chapter. Well, how many procrastinators do we have in here? Okay. You know why we procrastinate? I found this out. We do that because we feel like the task is so overwhelming that we really don't want to get into it because it's going to take too long and too much effort and all that kind of stuff, so we put it off. Anyway, it kept coming to me, and so I just kind of ignored it and thought, well, I'll do that when I have hour after hour that I can just do the study because I knew it wasn't going to be on one day. Very long time together. Long story short, my husband said, okay, we're going to do a baptism on Easter, and I knew that it was time because of that. Out of Numbers 19, I think around verse 13, it starts talking about the water of purification, which is kind of our baptism. But in this chapter, there are so many things, and I hope that I get out exactly what I want to get out tonight because I found some information that's going to blow the top of your head off. You know, it's exciting, but I'm not one that does what my husband does. I mean, I'm not anointed to be him, and he's not anointed to be me, but he can teach over the feast and different things like that and make it just sound so eloquent. So a lot of mine may be reading, but it's information that you absolutely have got to have. And hopefully, we'll be able to put together a study guide over it because there is so much stuff in this one chapter of the Bible, you're going to just be so surprised at what I found. Now, what it's about is ritual cleansing. How do you get clean in order to get into the presence of the Lord and to be able to have your prayer message and, you know, just have His presence and all that? So, let me tell you some information that I found out so that we can kind of get started on this thing. Anybody an end-time prophecy type person? Okay, you're going to love this then. They recently found out, well, let me just back up. In order for us to actually go to the heaven, we're waiting to be raptured out of here. As soon as we're raptured out, probably the third temple will be built. And so this third temple is already set up. A lot of it's already in trucks, loaded up so they can pre-plastic it and just slap it all together. So there's a few things that have to be ready. One of the things, of course, we know it's been the argument over the land that it's on and all that because they're thinking part of it's under, you know, the Muslim mosque and something like that. So I'm going to give you some information that's really going to excite you. And then I'm going to tell you some things that I hope you take good notes because I want you to look some of this stuff up. You're going to be very excited about it. Anyway, we're waiting for a red heifer to be born, right? There has to be a sacrifice of the red heifer. Now, since the first one that was done by Moses, God instructed Moses over what to do. Ezra was instructed over what to do, and he did one. There's only been 7 to 9 in the history of the world red heifers born. Now, let me tell you something very significant. 2002, one was born. It was taken to the temple for an evaluation. Well, they disqualified it because if you find any blemish on it, and I'll explain all that later, but if you find even the least little thing wrong with it, one white hair, one little scab, anything, then it disqualifies it. So they took it to the temple, and into the third year of examination, they found one tiny little flaw where it disqualified it. But think about this. As long as history has been going, how many thousands of years have we been here? There's only been 7 to 9 found since the beginning of where Adam started. There was born one in 2002. June 26, 2014, another one was born. June 26, July 13th, 2015, there was born one at the temple site, and the priests are still caring for it. Now, what they've got to do is they've got to examine this thing for 3 years, just like they did Jesus. We'll go into some of that later on. The priests are caring for it. Now, listen to this. February 7th, 2017, one was born in Mexico. They think is absolutely perfect, and we'll be able to do the sacrifice. Freaky, huh? Y'all should be more excited about that, because that means we'll be going home, amen? Now, we're waiting for this sacrifice, and it will be what the Jews say in prophecy. They've got several pieces in Scripture that says this. It says, when the 10th red heifer is born, guess which one this one was in Mexico? It was the 10th. They said, when that happens, look for the Messiah. The Messiah comes, and he's right here at the door. They're thinking that this possibly could be when the Messiah is returning. Isn't that exciting? Okay, so I want to build a little bit of history in here. I hope you can tolerate me. Later on, we'll go into what Christian baptism and all that kind of stuff is, but I wanted to kind of build a foundation, if that's okay with y'all. Okay, all right. Now, Numbers 19, it's all about the laws of purification. They have to have some of the ashes of the red heifer. Now, when Moses did that, all the ashes that have been saved since Moses, they still have some. They have to be mixed with the new ashes of the red heifer, and when that's done, they can actually do the sacrifice, and the Lord will return. Is what they're saying. Okay. But what happened was, they started waiting on this, and every single time there was a reason why they thought that they couldn't. Let me give you an example. If you even leaned on the red heifer, it disqualified you. I mean, they are super, super picky. But out of all of history, all of a sudden, bam, 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 in the last 2 years, there's a bunch of them being born. So that's pretty much an indication. This is number 10. So the rabbis are saying this is the one that will bring our Messiah. So in Numbers chapter 19, you want to turn over there with me. I've got it on the board, so everybody's just looking at it. Look at verse 20. This is why that we have to do this sacrifice for the Lord to return, because it is the offering of the red heifer, which is part of the laws of purification. Now, when we come to the Lord, we accept Jesus, and he starts to work on us, right? We're being purified. Well, to the Jews, there are rituals that they have to do. We do rituals. We do Christian baptism. We do communion, some other different things like that. But this is something they have to do for ritual purification. Now, I wondered, I don't know how many of you have wondered this too, what have they done to cover their sins since it's been that many thousands of years since they've had a sacrifice? Y'all ever wondered that? They're using their faith. So they're pleasing to the Lord because they're believing that that sacrifice, even though they're almost fasting for the last year, they're believing that that sacrifice has lasted several thousand years. Pretty amazing, isn't it? Okay, Numbers 19:20. But those who become defiled do not purify themselves, they will be cut off from the community. For they have defiled the sanctuary of the Lord, where his sanctuary are. So it says we have to purify ourselves and not be defiled in order for him to be able to come and live in us. Since the water of purification has not been sprinkled on them, they remain defiled. Now in this, I found out that there are four baptisms. You'll see the baptism of John, which was unto repentance, right? Now I'm going to freak y'all out with this. We'll go more into it later. But did you know that's not the baptism we use today? We think that baptism is for repentance. It's not. I'm going to prove that to you and show it to you. There's also, of course, we know the baptism of the Holy Spirit. There's the baptism into the body of Christ, but I'm going to hold one last one until we get a little bit further in this, okay? This offering that Moses was told by God, he said, I want you to, it's going to be a symbol of your salvation through the Messiah. So, the Israelites were not to question, because one thing that we all wonder is, why would blood, that's kind of sickening, and why would blood make me pure and all those kind of things? But they were told, and it's in all of their books that they had to learn to become a rabbi or whatever, they have to learn that you never question the offering system that God has set up. Now, we know because the blood of Jesus was very precious, and that's why it covers our sin, and he was the last sacrifice, but they don't believe like we do. Amen? Okay. So look at John 3, verse 5. And it says, Jesus answered and said, Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Did you see in there where it says, unless you were born of water? Now, I was raised Church of Christ. Church of Christ thinks that you get your salvation by baptism, which would make it a work, wouldn't it? We would have to labor to go get it. Now, this is how strong they believe it. They believe that if you die on the way to get baptized, when you get killed, you go to hell. That's how serious they are about it. But I have found out that it is one of the most important things, not only this scripture. It says you can't even enter into the kingdom of God unless you're born of water and of the Spirit. Now, some people say that being born of water is when the baby's carried in the womb, and it's when the water comes out because he's human and different things like that. But I'm going to prove to you that there are some things that are not accurate in the way that even we believe. So we want to kind of build a slow foundation, but then I want to tell you something before we leave tonight. Hopefully, I get that far into it. That's really going to be beneficial, going to help you. You want to tell everybody you know in a light Facebook up tonight. Okay. Romans chapter 8, verses 2 through 5. I'm worried out of the New Living Testament. And because you belong to him, the power of the life-giving Spirit has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death. Now, we're alive now. We're not dead. That's very significant. Pay attention to that. The law of Moses was unable to save us because of the weakness of our sinful nature. So God did what the law could not do. He sent his own son in a body like the bodies we sinners have. And in that body, God declared an end to sin's control over us by giving his son as a sacrifice for our sins. Verse 4. He did this. Now this is significant. He did this so that the just requirements of the law would be satisfied for us. So that no longer we follow our sinful nature, but instead we follow the Spirit. He did this. He met the requirements for us if we just follow the Spirit. Now I'm going to stop and say, those people that think you just say one little prayer and that's it, you're sealed and you are going to heaven, that's not according to this. You have to be led by the Spirit. In other words, you've got to have a relationship with him and you've got to follow him. Now, that's significant to us because a lot of times we do what we want to do. We don't ask the Holy Spirit. So we need to kind of back up and start asking the Holy Spirit, what do you think about this? Because he said, don't even say that we're going to go to town this week, we're going to do this. He said, don't even go through that because you really don't know. You really don't know what God's going to have you do. So he's telling you, watch your words, right? Verse 5. Those who are dominated by the sinful nature think about sinful things. But those who are controlled by the Holy Spirit think about the things that please the Spirit. So that's how, really, that you know you've got a relationship. You don't want to offend God, right? You know that if you smoke dope, you're offending God. You know that if you're sleeping around not married, you're offending God. So there gets this thing inside of you where you have no peace until you get right with him, and you just know when something is, maybe you've heard it from a sermon or whatever, you know that's something I've got to deal with, and I've got to do it now. That's being led by the Spirit, because when he highlights something, he's trying to show you, I need to make a correction in your life. But in this, I found that only God has the right to say what will atone for our sins. Now, I looked up the word atone, so let me read it to you. Atone means he purges. What's purging? Getting rid of stuff that doesn't need to be there, amen? Reconciliation, building a relationship with you. Forgiveness, purging away what doesn't belong there. Pacifying the Lord. Merciful, cleansed. Disannulled all the sins that were against us, appeased, pardoned, covered us, condoned us, I don't even know what some of these words are, placate or canceled the debt that we had, or to atone and cleanse us from our sins, forgiving and being merciful to us, and pardoning us and purging away what makes us unreconcilable. In other words, he's committed to getting you to heaven. He's saying that I'll take care of all of it, but you have to let me purge you. You have to let me do what I need to do, and you have to be led by me. It's not your own walk. This is a walk with God. Your life is not your own anymore. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, look in John chapter 1, verse 12. But as many are, as received him, to them he gave them the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe. Now Romans 7, 4 and 8 says this. We are dead to the law. The law showed me my sin. That's why a lot of people don't want to come to church, because they don't want to look at their sin. Amen? But it says even the Old Testament, it showed you your sin. But if there was no law, sin would have no power. So now that we know when we're sinning, because he says in Romans 2, he's got a written law that's in our heart so that we might not sin against him. We know when we are screwing up. Amen? Okay. Romans 7, 9. But one time I lived without understanding the law. But when I learned the commandments not to covet, for instance, the power of sin came to life. So all of a sudden, you're starting to have this battle before you didn't care what you did. And now you've got this battle going on inside of you. So the Jewish rabbis would take this, the ashes, and they would pour it into an offering, and then they would sprinkle it upon the people. We're going to look at some of that. The ashes would contain the blood and other different things in there. The whole thing is like, you know, you're taking the whole body of Christ and you're throwing it upon those to make them clean, okay? So as far as the Jewish rabbis go, they're saying that there are sacrifices, there are some that are clean and some that are unclean. But it's only ceremonially unclean. Let me give you an example. A dirty dish, still a usable dish, but it's dirty, right? All you got to do is wash it and clean it and all that kind of stuff. So I looked up what the Jewish meaning behind this. The word is called tahor. That means you are clean. Clean means you're usable to the Lord. If you're not clean, he can't use you. So when a vessel was unclean, when a vessel was clean, it meant that you had an open manifestation. You could come into God's presence and he could speak to you. But if you have dirt on you, if you're unclean in any way, then you cannot come into his presence and he gives you no revelation. He gives you no understanding of the word. Have you ever had somebody say, well, I don't understand the word? It's because there's something that's unclean in you that God wants you to get out of your life so that there's an open manifestation of his presence in your life. Making sense? Okay. Now, tahor is, or tamei, means unclean. It means you need to be purified. And it's symbolic of the hidden things of God. God has things in scriptures that he wants us to find. Just like with this Numbers, there was something he wanted me to find. But I had to purify myself. Okay, Lord, I'm going to deny myself the right to watch TV, to hang out with everybody, because it takes hours and hours and hours of looking up different things and making sure you're saying it accurately. But when you do that, you'll find the hidden things that are there just for you. So he's saying, get unclean, get rid of that stuff, be purified, and all of a sudden the hidden things of God start coming to the surface. So as far as the Jews, if they were going to do a sacrifice, that sacrifice had to be clean. And they believed when they had that sacrifice that it would open the heavens and that they would receive something from God. Okay? So if we're not clean, we can't hear as well from the Lord, right? And we're not usable. Okay, so we've got to get clean. All right, so as far as the Jews, there's a preparation in order to get the dish clean or to be usable. But first of all, the vessel had to be dedicated to the Lord. That means you have to be, that's your number one thing. It's not, I got to go get a drink, I got to go, you know, I got to get a girl, all those things. You've got to dedicate this whole temple. Okay, God, that means I'm in the fight. I know that you reveal my sin and you want me to deal with it. I need your help to walk through this because I want to be usable. So in Numbers chapter 8, verse 11, it says this. Raising his hands, Aaron must then present the Levites to the Lord as a special offering. So even the priest had to become an offering to the Lord. It said it had to be a special offering from the people of Israel, thus dedicating them to the Lord's service. Now, I don't know how yours was done, but when I came into the ministry, I'd already been going into, you know, to jails and different things like that, used by the Lord. But when it was time to go into my position as a pastor instead of just a, you know, person that, you know, was ministering as a whatever teacher, we had a service for me, and they put a robe on me and commanded the spirit, and it was different. It changed my life when we had that special ceremony to set me apart just like this, but I didn't know that that was part of it, that there was a special dedication of the priest. When Kenneth Copeland came here, he laid hands on us and he said, I impart my mantle into you, not as I was in the beginning, but as I am right now. It changed my life. That's when I started the Bible college in the prison. So both of these things were, I was presenting my body, okay, God, I'll let you do whatever you want to do with me. I'm putting myself as an offering, okay? All right, so he raised his hands, and then they would present the priest to the Lord, and they would say, Lord, this is your vessel. They're going to be willing to do whatever you need to do in order to fulfill what your mission is for them. So now let's look at the Message Bible, Numbers 8, verses 10 through 15. It's going to be a little bit of reading today, so we'll get to this point. I really believe we will. If not, I'll keep you till about 10 or so. Okay, present the Levites before God as the people of Israel laid their hands on them. So everybody laid their hands on them. Aaron will present the Levites before God as a wave offering. Now, if you don't know what a wave offering is, if you're, say for instance, let me just do it like this. If I was holding hands with somebody, we would lift it up before the Lord, bring it down, take it to the left, take it to the right, which is the sign of a cross, isn't it? That was the wave offering. They have no idea why it's in that shape. They just do it out of obligation because that's what they're supposed to do. Okay, so they're making the sign of the cross in this, with this wave offering. From the people of Israel so that they will be ready to do God's work. Have the Levites, have you ever thought about some Catholics, that's what they do, they make the sign of the cross over you. That's where they got this. Did you know that? Okay. So that they will be ready to do God's work. Verse 12. Have the Levites place their hands on the heads of the bulls, selecting one for the absolution offering. Now the absolution offering is removal of sin. Okay? And another for the whole burnt offering. Now Jesus became the whole burnt offering when he went to hell. To God to make an atonement, or to be at one with, that's the easy way to remember, atonement, at one with him, with God, for the Levites. Then have the Levites stand in front of Aaron and his sons and present them as a wave offering to God. This is the procedure for setting apart the Levites from the rest of the people. So pastors are different than the rest of the people. Don't always like that because it does feel lonely and different thing. You're put on a magnifying glass and everything you do, say, look, movements, everything else is all judged by the people around you. What you watch on TV, what you try, everything when you get into this position is judged. Did you know that? Okay. Okay, so it says, after you have purified the Levites, present them as a wave offering to God. Now, they had to go to work in what was called the tent of meeting, which is basically before the temple was built, you know, with stone and all that kind of stuff. They had a tent. Y'all have probably seen pictures of it, you know, where they had, you know, several sections to it. You had to go into the tent of meeting, then you go through purification. We'll go through all that, and I'll explain all that to you as to why they do each little purification and what it means to us, because there is a significance of what the Jews do, and they don't even know that it is Christian, but they do it, okay? Let's get excited in this place. I can tell y'all are having fun, okay. So they go through this ceremony of cleansing, and the reason they go through this ceremony of cleansing is so that they won't be cut off from the community. If you don't cleanse yourself, you won't go to heaven. That's the community it means for us. So we all know, we've seen the pictures of the priest going in there. You know, he had this robe on, he had the breastplate, and he had the bells on the bottom of it, he had the pomegranates on there and all that kind of stuff. And the reason they wore the bells, for you guys that don't know that, is because if he hadn't totally gotten rid of all his sin and the people's sin, he was struck dead. Because you can't go into the presence of a holy God with sin in there. So I'm sure they were grieving all year, oh God, please, like, you know. So they're wearing these bells and whatever, so that the people would know, and they tied this rope around their ankles, so that if they quit hearing the bells, they drove them out of there because God had struck them dead, and the sins were not covered for the people for that year, okay? So so after they pull this rope thing out, the sound that they heard was they would hear the presence of the Lord come. And the people were anxiously standing right outside the tent, right outside the temple, waiting to see if they heard, listen to this, a rushing wind. Interesting, huh? That the Holy Spirit comes as a mighty rushing wind. Okay. So, we know that you can't touch anything unclean because it defiles you as far as Jews go. Now, Leviticus chapter 5, verse 2. If a soul touch anything unclean, whether it be a carcass of an unclean beast or a carcass of an unclean cattle or the carcass of an unclean creeping thing, if it be hidden from him, he shall also be unclean and guilty. That means he's not usable. But even when they went to do the sacrifice, after they did the sacrifice, they became unclean until the evening. Okay, so this scripture is actually talking about you can't touch anything dead. That's why we separate from those that are not Christians. We're nice to them. We witness to them. We just don't hang out with them because dirt will get on you. Amen? Okay. So that's basically, we'll look at a bridge that they cross over here very shortly to get past all the dead bodies of a cemetery to get into the presence of the Lord, because there's a walk that you have to take through the dry bone cemetery to get into the presence of the Lord. I'll show you that before this teaching's over with. Okay, here it is in the Message Bible, Leviticus 5, verses 3 and 4. If you touch a human uncleanness of any sort, a ritually contaminated uncleanness, and you're not aware of it at the time, that means it can happen and you don't even realize it. Now you see why the Jews pray, what, six times a day? God, if there's anything that happened, and I don't even know about it, I don't want to be unclean. But later you realize that you're guilty, or if you impulsively swear to do something. How many of you guys have promised the Lord you'd do something, but you didn't do it? Okay. If you impulsively swear to do something, whether good or bad, some rash oath just pops out, and you aren't aware of what you've done at the time, but later you come to realize that you are guilty in all of these cases. If you're guilty in one part of the law, you're guilty of all the law. Okay. So he's basically saying separate from the dead thing. And we'll go more into that. But he's saying that when you have this blood sacrifice of the red heifer and it comes into that water, it makes you clean. And it is called the ritual of water purification. Now, it doesn't make really much difference in the water because you wouldn't want to drink out of it. But it makes that blood and that sacrifice go on you, so now you're purified, and that's part of what baptism does. You go down, the old man dies, and you come up a different person, right? We're going to look at a whole bunch of that. Okay, and so it says that we are redeemed. So this is what redeemed me. This was so awful. Awful. Okay, redeemed, to make up for your faults. You know, I'm not perfect. None of y'all are perfect. I know you. You're definitely not perfect. But he makes up for your faults. When he redeemed you, he purchased you, and now you have no faults because his blood covered as a sacrifice of your sin. Listen, last part of this. It makes up for past bad performances. It saves us from sin and fulfills a pledge or promise. It actually buys your freedom. That's why it says when we're free in Christ, it actually bought it for us. Okay, Numbers 19, verses 17 and 18. To remove the defilement, put some of the ashes from the burnt purification offering in a jar and pour fresh water over them. Then someone who is ceremonially clean must take a hyssop branch, and we'll look at what hyssop does. It's amazing what hyssop and the scarlet wool and some of those things that happened that they were put in these ritual sacrifices, the things that they represent to us. Oh, I can't wait for y'all to get to that. Anyway, Numbers 19:1-2. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron, here's another legal requirement commanded by the Lord. Tell the people of Israel to bring you a red heifer, a perfect animal that has no defects and has never been yoked. Now, a yoke was put on there to what? work that animal, right? He's saying that there's no work to get into his presence or into his community. It's all done by faith. Okay. So we know this sacrifice had to have no other color but red, but something you probably didn't realize is the nose has to be red and the hoofs have to be red. There is nothing on that animal that is any other color than red. That's why it's so significant that all of a sudden here they are popping up everywhere. Okay. It also, the one that disqualified back in 2002, he had a little scratch or something on him. And, you know, just walking through gates, you can get a little scratch, but it disqualified him. So it had to be a perfect sacrifice, and no yoke ever had to be placed on it. Not even a blanket. If you put a blanket on that animal, it disqualified it. Why? Because you were carrying something. That's why God says don't carry these burdens. But what do? Oh, I've done this. I deserve this. Anybody else like me? Okay, I hear the rustling. And you can't even really touch it with a rope unless the animal is fixing to die. And it's in the interest of the animal, then you can use a rope to try to lead the weight. In other words, it has to be untouched. Okay. Now we're going to get into some stuff which I think is really, really going to bless you. Okay. In Jerusalem, when you take a look at the temple that Nehemiah built, remember? Okay. It had a wall all around the city. When you look at this drawing of what Nehemiah built, at the far end of it, it's kind of open and it starts with the sheep gate. Guess who we are? We're the sheep. Okay. When you look at a map of this, it looks like a footprint. So this is the way for the sheep to go in. Isn't that awesome? And it starts with the sheep gate, goes all the way around. Just before you get back to the sheep gate, there's the inspection gate. Interesting. Okay. Okay, you have these mountain ranges. There's going to be three different ones there in Israel. One of them is Mount Moriah, and that's where you've all seen the Temple Mount, you know, where they have, you know, the big dome of the rock and all that kind of stuff. And then there's the wall there, the Wailing Wall and so forth like that. And, you know, for how many years we've been fighting over this little tiny bit of property there. Okay, I'm just going to hold off on that for a second. Next, you'll see in between the next mountain, and this one, there was a Kidron Valley. Right outside of this Kidron Valley, next to Mount Moriah and next to the Mount of Olives, this valley is called the Way of Sorrow. And they say that it is the portal unto death. Interesting, huh? And it also means, when you look up Kidron, it means depressed in spirit, crushed beneath burdens. So that's how you feel it. When you're down in that valley, you kind of feel like you're crushed, don't you? Okay. So on the other side, after you go to Mount Moriah, you go through the Kidron Valley, and here you come to the Mount of Olives. Y'all ever heard of that? I thought it was one mountain. It's not. It's a range of mountains. There's a whole bunch of them there. But when Jesus was crucified, guess where he was crucified? Mount of Olives. Guess where he's going to return? The Mount of Olives. And he's going to come and split them in two. We'll go more into that later on. But the next one is, and this is how the Jews say it, Mount Zion. But to us it would be Zion, or like the heavenly city, okay? So all of Israel calls it Zion, okay? And it's the city where David had built it, and it also represents the heavenly city or the kingdom of heaven. Okay. Now, when you have a mountain, what they would do is at the top of the mountain, they would flatten the top of the mountain. They would just cut the stone until it was totally flat at the top. Now, what was built on the top of this was, remember it says don't go into the high places, because that's where a lot of demonic sacrifices and so forth were made. On the top of that mountain is where the Dome of the Rock is. Now, let me tell you something significant that's going to blow your mind. They've been fighting over this little top of the mountain thing, and the Bible specifically says, don't go to the high places. Okay. When you built a Jewish synagogue back a long time ago after, you know, they started building it with stone and so forth, like, 3/4 of the way down the mountain is where they would build the synagogues for the Jews. Not on the top of the mountain, where the Dome of the Rock is, but down, 3/4 of the way down the mountain. Now, when we went over there, we saw a bunch of even Catholic ones where they had the monks and so forth. And I thought, how strange, because there was mountains, and I mean, it was just almost straight up and down rock. But 3/4 of the way down this, there's all these temples built into the rock, and I'm thinking, why wouldn't you build it up high? But that's why, because it says don't build it. Don't go up to the high places, because that's where they did demonic sacrifices. Okay. Y'all get me so far? Am I making it clear? Okay. Now, there are several different things that we as Christians do, but it has kind of a pagan root to it. Okay. Baal, y'all know who Baal is, right? You know, has the head of a cow with the horns, and then it has a man's body and something like that. And Ashtoreth were actually where the Dome of the Rock was. That's actually where they actually started having sacrifices on the top of that mountain, on the high places, okay? Now listen to this. You need to write this down, look this up. It's going to blow you away. There's a man called Tuvit Savage. And I hope I'm saying it right. He is a Jewish architect, and he believed that God was smarter than to have them argue over this little piece of land for all this time. Okay? Now, this is the third temple. First one torn down, last one was torn down. Now they're wanting to rebuild this third temple. So they've been arguing because they think part of it is supposed to be, and they think that it has to be in the original place, it has to be under part of the Dome of the Rock. Well, the Muslims are not going to have that. You are not taking their land, and you are not taking their temple. And we have pictures of, we had them in the bookstore for a little while, where we took pictures of the Dome of the Rock, and the outside was marble, and it had demonic heads in it. You look at it, and you can see demonic faces. It was freaky, okay? So anyway, this Jewish architect, Tuvia, he remembered that the temples were built instead of on the high places, they were built 3/4 of the way down the mountain. So he perceived that the Jews were arguing with the Muslims over a wrong space to have the temple built. So he said, God's too smart for that. So he went and he got permission to fly over the area in a helicopter and to use radioactive waves with infrared over the whole area. Now, infrared picks up heat. You see a body, you see somebody walking because there's heat in them, okay? When you have rock, or you have something that's got rock in it, it'll hold the heat for a long time, right? Okay. So this infrared will pick up the heat that's there. So the sun beats down on all these rocks and all that kind of stuff to warm it. And when it starts to cool, the ones that are not solid rock don't light up anymore because it's not solid, it's not holding that, because there's cracks and the heat's getting out. So what will happen is, you'll begin to see what this man said. I believe he's very accurate. Rock holds more heat than dirt. You ever seen, like, you know, you drive down the road at night and rattlesnakes are out there because they're trying to get warm because there's rock in the road, right? Okay, so he started running this infrared over this whole area, and he found the shape of an octagon inside of there. Now, Ashtoreth had built a temple in the shape of an octagon. So he saw that where this temple had been built, and it was right under the Dome of the Rock. So that was where Ashtoreth, and they actually said that Ashtoreth fell from heaven in an egg, and we now call it Easter, fell from heaven in this egg, and so they worshiped this deity on the top of the mountain, right there in an octagon-shaped building that's underneath there. And so they had built a temple to not only to her, but to a Phoenician goddess, and that's the one that we celebrated Easter today. Remember how we had the Easter eggs and all that kind of stuff? That's where it came from. Okay. Okay, it says that she came down from heaven in an egg and so forth like that. Think about what we've been teaching on Sunday night, this fallen angel technology and so forth like that. We watched a show the other night. What was it called? That one with, we bought the movie. Arrival. Okay. In this movie, Arrival, they had UFOs that showed up, and these UFOs were egg shapes, and they came down on there, and it was kind of, you started realizing, wait a minute, maybe that was angel technology bringing that down, causing them to worship all these idols and so forth like that. Anyway, what he discovered was, because of the heat, when he finally found, right next to the very beginning of the wailing wall, and back in between the next building that comes up, which is where the Jewish people think that it is, because they think it needs to be big and so forth, because they thought that's what Nehemiah said. But they found out that the temple is much smaller than what they thought. So right underneath where the wailing wall is, and just almost to that next building, he found a structure that they think is the temple. So you will not have to tear down the Dome of the Rock. You won't have to tear up the southern temple, so, which is what the Muslims want to do. They're like, well, let's tear up your temple. So they're saying that there's an argument between all of them right now, and they said as far as last week, there may be an agreement over it, that they may have found the temple. And I feel the Holy Ghost as I'm saying it. They may have found the temple, and when they found it, it's already ready to go up. It's sitting on the back of trucks, prefab, and it's up in less than 3 months. When they do that, the sacrifice is done and the Messiah comes as far as the Jews go. Okay. So the temple is only half of what it was in that day. So in the first century, there was a thing called the Hasmonean dynasty in 140 AD. It was part of the Maccabean family, a ruling dynasty in Judea. And they were the ones that they're checking on some of their information to try to prove. Now, Maccabees is in the Catholic Bible, right? These are the same one. They're trying to show that it possibly is in their information also. And if it is, that'll clarify it, and that'll mean that we can go ahead and do it, okay? So they're just arguing off this little tiny bit. I see, I was all over the place. Who's going to tell somebody? So it's very significant. I mean, Jesus is fixing to come back. Even the Jews know it. Okay. So they've got the tenth heifer that's been, so they have to look at it just like they did with Jesus. They had to examine Jesus for 3 years. They have to examine this heifer for 3 years to see if it's perfect and went without defect. So it looks like they may possibly have 2 to 3 that they're looking at to see if there's a possibility they could go ahead and use it for sacrifice. Now what they've done is, these priests have already gone through the training to do what they need to do. When my husband and I went, the menorah that's there has, you know, remember when you were reading some of the Old Testament, Esther and so forth, you know how they had the candlestick and head off. This thing is massive. It's probably not quite as tall as this ceiling, but it's massive. I mean, it's huge. Maybe half of where the bars are here and maybe up to the fan. That's how tall this thing is. And you're supposed to keep the fire burning in it all the time. Now, and with Esther, the reason they thought hers was so significant is because even when there was no oil, it kept burning. So they've already started getting this ready. So they're ready to light these things. They have the incense. They have the whole thing ready to go. Okay? All right. Nehemiah chapter 3, verse 1. Then Elishab, the high priest, and the other priests started to rebuild at the Sheep Gate. They dedicated it and set up its doors, building the wall as far as the Tower of Hundred, which they dedicated the Tower of Hanel. So these people went out and they built the walls with their own money, with their own time, and with their own efforts. And what they do? They had a sword in one hand, right?
Yes.
And they were building with the other hand. So it's just like us. We have to fight. And we got to stay in Him. Fight, stay in Him. Fight, stay in Him. Right? So they invested their lives into this because it was their city. And they knew how significant it was. So it starts with the Sheep Gate on the end of the foot. You go in the Sheep Gate. It goes all the way around. So listen to this. Nehemiah 3:31. Makaha, one of the goldsmiths, repaired the wall as far as the housing for the temple servants and merchants across from the inspection gate. Now, like I said, when you go around this footprint, right before you get there, there'll be an inspection before you can get in the gate to go into the heavenly city. So it continued as far as the upper room in the corner. So it begins with the sheep gate and ends with the sheep gate. Okay, so prophetically, that's one of the last gates or the place where he will return to inspect his sheep, because it's right on the top of where he comes back, splits that mountain. Okay, so here's the inspection gate. The gate is called, in Jewish language, Mishka, the eastern gate, where Jesus will appear, split the mountain in two. He's the gate. We go through him to get in the sheep gate. We will be inspected as we come in to see if you are really one of his sheep. Matthew chapter 7, verse 13. Enter ye into the straight gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leads to destruction. So it's narrow. Now, leading up to this, now what you got to do, and we'll go over some scriptures about this in a minute. When Jesus died, they put him right outside of the city. And there's the tomb, which is right next to it. You can see the big rock that was blown back when Jesus, you know, came out of the tomb. But right there on the, it looks like a skull. On the top of that is where Jesus was crucified. And there is a narrow road to get into Jerusalem that way. And as you go down this narrow road, guess what you have to do? You have to look at the cross. It's right there. There's nothing else there. It's just a little tiny road. So you have to look in order to keep going down that road. You got to look at the cross. Because that's the straight gate that he's talking about. You got to look at me and deal with me. Acts 14, 13. In front of the city gate stood a temple of Jupiter, and his priests started to make sacrifice to the apostles. Here it is out of the New Living Testament. Now, the temple of Zeus was located just outside of town. So the priests of the temple and the crowds brought bulls and wreaths and flowers in the town gates. They prepared to offer sacrifices to the apostles. Now, what I want you to see is, as you're going down here, just before you get to this, there are temples to Zeus. So, in other words, there's lots of distractions on your way to the cross to go down that narrow road. There's things trying to pull you off all over the place, and they are demonic. So there's lots of obstacles you got to go, and it's just this little tiny road. Okay, Numbers chapter 19, verse 20. But the man that shall be unclean and shall not purify himself, that soul shall be cut off from among the congregation, because he has defiled the sanctuary. The water of separation has not been sprinkled upon him, and therefore he is unclean. Now, this scripture is where a lot of religions say that sprinkling is what makes you clean. So you start to see why different religions popped out of all this. Some of the Catholics do, the Episcopals do, several other different religions sprinkle. Now, when you look it up, we'll go with that, and I don't want to go there. Okay. So let's talk about the inspection gate here for just a second, where he's going to divide the sheep from the goats. He's going to do that examination to see if you actually make it into. Now, I'm going to scare you a little bit, because I want you to think about this. When Noah was here, how many people made it into heaven?
Eight.
It's a mighty narrow gate, isn't it? Think how many people are in the world. So I don't care what you got to do to kill that flesh. Be better to be a little bit afraid of it and get in. Amen? All right. I think y'all just sucked all the air out of the room. Matthew chapter 25, verses 32 through 46. We'll read out the Message Bible. Then all the nations will be arranged before him. He will sort the people out, much as a shepherd sorts out sheep and goats. Putting sheep on his right hand means fellowship. That means you have a relationship with him. You're accepted. In fact, if you're a left-handed in Israel, you're considered cursed, because you don't have the right hand of fellowship. Okay. Putting sheep on his right and goats on his left, then the king will say to those on his right, enter in, you who are blessed by my Father, take what's coming to you in this kingdom. It's been ready for you since the world's foundation. And here's why. So if it's all been ready for us, what's Jesus building right now? If it's already ready, what's he building? Interesting. And here's why I was hungry. Oh, and here's why. I was hungry and you fed me. So it's important to feed the poor, right? That's why Jesus said, what was he talking about? To enter into the kingdom of God. Okay. You got to feed the hungry. I was thirsty. You gave me a drink. I was homeless. You gave me a room. Now, how many people want to take a homeless person home with them? Kind of gets to you, doesn't it? I was shivering and you gave me clothes. I was sick and you stopped to visit. I was in prison and you came to me. Then those sheep are going to say, Master, what are you talking about? When did we ever see you hungry and feed you, thirsty and give you drink? And when did we ever see you sick or in prison and come to you? And the king will say, I'm telling the solemn truth. Whenever you did it to one of these things, to someone overlooked or ignored, that was me. You did it for me. It's easy to overlook stuff and ignore it because we have a busy life. I'm too busy for that. I'm too busy to go volunteer my time. I'm too busy to feed the poor. I'm too busy to witness. And he will turn to the goats, the one who's left, and say, get out, worthless goats. You're good for nothing but the fires of hell. And why? Because I was hungry, you gave me no meal. I was thirsty, you gave me no drink. I was homeless, you gave me no bed. I was shivering, and you gave me no clothes. Sick and in prison, and you never visited. Then those goats are going to say, Master, what are you talking about? When did we ever see you hungry or thirsty or homeless or shivering or sick or in prison? And didn't help, and he will answer them. I'm telling you the solemn truth. When you fail to do one of these things to someone who was being overlooked and ignored, that was me. You failed to do it to me. Then those goats will be herded to their eternal doom, but the sheep to their eternal reward. So, as we go through scriptures, every one of those things is the inspection gate. Those things are inspecting you to see if there's a blemish, a flaw, or anything else that would keep you from getting into the sheep gate. So when you look at this word, it's misqua, which means you're inspected. It means to count. Now, when you go to this particular gate called the inspection gate, guess what it really is? It's a counting place. It's where they take the census to see how many are coming into the city. So right there is the designated spot where God counts the sheep before they come in. Those belong to me, those don't. Yet they were together, nobody knew the difference. And it also says, Mitzvah says that there's a census or a number that will be allowed into the city. Now you guys can look up these words for yourself. I'm not making this up to try to make myself look good. Okay? Luke 21, 24. And they shall fall by the edge of the sword and be led away captive unto all nations, and to Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles. Now listen to this. Until the times of the Gentiles is fulfilled. God has a certain amount of people that he wants, and that's who he's calling. And I'm sure that's why the times of the Gentiles has lasted a little bit longer than what we expect, because the Jews are going, now wait a minute here, this makes no sense. We've counted this off. We know that the difference between the calendar, the Gregorian calendar, and this other calendar is not making any sense, but it's really not that far off. But he forgot about the church age and forgot about us, that we were going to be engrafted in, and so we are the Gentiles that are going to fulfill this number. So when the last Gentile comes in, the times of the Gentiles will be fulfilled. Is it making sense? Okay. So the Lord is going to be dealing with a lot of Gentiles. So how do you know the next time you walk up to somebody and witness to them, this time they're not going to bite your head off, but they're going to say, okay, I'll come to church with you. I'll turn my life around. How do you know that's not the one that God's waiting on? Wouldn't that be neat to be the person that got that last one that God said, finally, there's one not yet, right? So as soon as we leave and we're out of here, of course, the Lord's going to turn back to the Jews and start dealing with the Jews and so forth, and it'll be 7 years tribulation and all that kind of stuff. And hopefully, you won't be here for that. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Okay. So I want to talk to you about the different kinds of offerings that the Lord required, okay? There was the wave offering. Of course, I told you that one. It was to get rid of the guilt. So every time you start feeling guilty, what do? I am forgiven. I'm going to put that wave offering over me. I am covered by the cross. I'm just not going to do it anymore. I want in the gate. So out of this, they were supposed to give, out of this wave offering, this guilt offering, they were supposed to give the priest the right thigh, and that's supposed to represent our walk with God. They were supposed to give the priest their walk with God. So guess what we're here for? To torture you, to teach you, to show you which way to go. Because we're concerned about your walk with God. Not because I want to be controlling or I want your information or I want to know something about you. I have no hidden motive. I'm not trying to get nothing out of you. Did you know that? It's a kind of a miserable place to be in there because not everybody likes it. Not everybody wants to be corrected.
That's good preaching now. Come on. I understand that.
Okay, the next one is the burnt offering. This one is the one that atones or makes up for your sin. It represents the whole person of Jesus so that our performance of what we're doing will be accepted. Now, I don't know about you, when I do something for God and I get in there and it doesn't turn out the way I think that it should, I'm thinking, God, are you even going to, did I mess up too bad? No, he's going to perfect that. You were trying. Okay? Leviticus chapter 1, verse 3 says this. If his offering be a burnt offering of the herd, let him offer a male without blemish, that was Jesus, and he shall offer it of his own voluntary will at the door of the tabernacle. Guess what we are? Tabernacles, tents, walking about with the Lord's presence in us. And it'll be by your voluntary will before you let it in to the tabernacle of the congregation before the Lord. So the third one is a drink offering. It represents the believer who has poured himself out in service for the Lord. Isn't that neat? You feel like, dang, I'm at church every single day. Guess what? It's a drink offering to the Lord. He's not going to forget. He's not going to forget your labor of love. He's not going to know how many people you've been witnessing, trying to encourage them, bringing them into the kingdom, how much you've prayed for others. You know, whatever your gift is, if you're an intercessor, then he's going to expect for you to do your job. And that's how you pour yourself out as a drink offering to him. The next one, number four, is a meat offering. And it should be called the mealtime offering. Remember when we forget to pray before our meal? That's a meat offering. We forget to give him his. But this is what a meat or a meal offering does. It saves us from the wrath of God. Here it is. Romans chapter 5, verses 9 and 10. Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. He's the one that saves us from this wrath. Verse 10, for if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. So if it's part of the meal offering or the meat offering, he's expecting you to be grateful for every single thing that goes on in your life. God, thank you that I got a car to get here to church. Thank you I had gas to get here. Thank you because I had something to eat today. Thank you. All those are considered an offering to the Lord. Had one of the girls at the prison came up to me and said, Pastor Karen, I don't have anything. But I want to give back to him something, even though I don't have any money, how can I give to the Lord? All these things I'm mentioning to you, all those are an offering to him, and he keeps them. Okay. Number five is a peace offering. Of course, we know that Jesus is our peace. Amen? But let me give you some commands that were supposed to be made or met in order to give a peace offering. You had to bring either a male or a female of the cattle, and this is what it would cost if you were to bring this. Today, it would cost you $350 for a female or $800 for a male. Guess what? He's saying, I'll look at what you bring financially to the church. And I'll prove some of that here pretty soon. I don't know whether we'll get there tonight, but okay. Number two, it shall be without blemish. Number three, the offerer shall lay his hands on the head of his offering and kill it at the door of the outer court, Leviticus 3:2. Now remember when we tell you to come up and at least touch the basket? You're offering your hands. Okay, God, I'm not going to lie to you. I really didn't have anything to bring up here. But I'm going to offer, I'm going to bless this offering. I'm going to command it to multiply so that the needs of your house are met. See, he looks at every little tiny thing to determine, are you a sheep or are you a goat? Goats are always arguing about everything. Got to have their nose in everybody's business, got to know what's going on, telling everybody else, all those kind of things. So he's saying, when you have this offering, lay your hands on it right here at the door of the court tabernacle. So that's what you do. Lord, I just offer this to you. I pray that it's a sweet savor unto you, that it'll be something that you, God, will receive. Did you know that the Jewish, when they did the offering of the meat or heifer or whatever, it determined if the smoke went up, the acceptable offering was given. If not, they gave something, and God said, I'm not receiving it. Wrong motive, wrong attitude, whatever. You understand? All the things of God are holy. And he won't take this junk that we have learned to do as Americans. He requires commitment to him. He requires you to do exactly what the word says to do. Amen? Amen. All right. I know y'all are excited. I can tell already. Next, it says that the priest shall sprinkle the blood on the brazen altar. Now, the brazen altar was symbolic of sin. So they're sprinkling the blood of Jesus on my sin. God, I am a sinner, and we've all heard, I'm not a sinner anymore, I'm saved by grace. Yes, you are, but you still sin. And sometimes you got to stop yourself and say, I need to put some blood of Jesus on here. My attitude's way off. I am mean to people. I am hateful. I don't want to give. I don't want to. Amen? Amen. Number five, they shall burn on the altar the fat that covers the inwards, the kidneys and the fat on them, a gall above the liver. Number six, bring a lamb for an offering. Now, if they were to bring a lamb, now realize every time they went to the temple, to the church, they had to bring an offering. It was not acceptable to come into the presence of the king without an offering. But if you brought a lamb for an offering today, that would be $80 for you. So the offerer were to lay his hands on the lamb's head or whatever your offering is and kill it before the tabernacle. So sometimes you do have to kill your flesh to be able to give what God wants you to give. Amen? Y'all know what I'm talking about. We have to do it too. We're not exempt from that. We're just like you people. We still have to give tithe. We still have to give offering. We still have to give time, all those kind of things. Okay. Number eight, the priest shall sprinkle blood on the brazen altar. So put it over the sin. Number nine, the priest shall burn on the altar all the fat, the whole rump, which weighed about 40 pounds. Now realize these people are dragging this stuff to church with them. I brought my offering. It's cost me $80, and I had to drag this 40-pound thing up here so you could give it as an offering to the Lord. And it says that you would have the kidneys, their fat, and the gall of the liver. Or you could bring a goat as an offering. A goat cost you $50. So the offerer, of course, would lay their hands on the goat's head and kill it before the tabernacle. Now, we'll get into some of this later with the offering of the goat. The offering of the goat was to take the sin away from the camp. It was actually the scapegoat to say, take these sins away from my whole household and go out there in the desert. Okay? Number 12, the priest shall sprinkle blood on the altar. So, I don't know what y'all do while worship is going on. I'm saying, God, I pray that everybody that's in here will get a revelation of you, that their spiritual eyes will be open, that you'll receive their offering, number one, of praise, but their offering of their life, their money, their finances, everything they're giving to you. Lord, I ask you to purify it so that they can bring to you the right kind of offering. Father, I ask you to do that in Jesus' name. Guess what? In the name of Jesus, just sprinkle blood on the altar for you. Number 13, priests shall burn on the altar the fat and the inwards, the kidneys, and their fat above the liver. Number 14, and you shall not eat any fat or blood through your generations. Fat is an offering to the Lord. I don't know if you knew that, but an offering to the Lord of fat was anything that was excess. Got extra money. Oh, what am I going to do this? Let's go shopping. Let's go do this. Let's do, right? That was supposed to be a fat offering to the Lord. No, Lord, I give it to you. Whatever you purpose to do with it, once I hand it over, it belongs to you. Wow. Number six, the ignorance offering. So they gave an offering for the times where they committed sins and didn't even know about it. You said something later on, it came back on you, and that person's as mad as a wet hen. And you're like, I didn't even mean to do that, but you did it in ignorance. So this is happening a whole bunch. I don't know about y'all, but I have to go back to the Lord and say, God, I was just totally ignorant. I really need some of your wisdom. And we went to the show last night, and I was some of you guys are with us, in this particular show, the shack that we saw, when this guy went to the mountain, it was just standing there. He was supposed to keep going in there, so he walked right through the obstacles and everything, got in there, and on a throne sitting up here was a woman, and that woman was supposed to represent wisdom. So she said, "You're here for judgment." And so he just really had a bad attitude towards God and everybody else because he lost his daughter and so forth like that. So he said, "Who gives you the right to judge me?" And she said, "I'm not judging you. You're judging everybody else. You get up there on that throne. You became the judge. You sentenced those people." So that's what it means. Anyway, the next one is the trespass offering, which are sins that are committed on a daily basis related to our conduct or our character. Now, when you look this up, it means that if you've offended someone with what you've said, you've been smart alecky, hateful with what you've said, had an attitude, all those kind of things, those things are like going over into God's property. Remember when you have a property line right here? And you go over into that, you've trespassed on that, and there's consequences in there. So guess what? Those little sins that you think that your conduct, you pitching a fit, screaming, yelling, beating walls, whatever, you're, I don't know what your thing is, but that is a trespass offering. And guess what? You went over into God's property. So guess what? You owe God repentance. That's what the trespass offering is. Now, I understand this is what the Jews, but it means some significant things to us. So I'm not trying to make anybody feel guilty. Y'all understand that? I'm just presenting the word. I didn't write it. I'm just up here preaching. Okay. Number 8, a sin offering. It represents the suffering that the Lord Jesus Christ had to go through for us. So we're thinking, sin offering, good. I messed up. It's covered. No, this is when we remember, okay, God, I sinned. I didn't sin just against me. I sinned against you, and I sinned against heaven. So that's what a sin offering is. Number 9, a heave offering. This is the offering that we give to the Lord of our time, our talents, our activities, or show how much we love him. Guess how they did it? Like this. You know how people don't want to raise their hands? Guess who you're doing it for? It's not for you. It's for him. And so we're heaving up our love to him. We're lifting up and we're ignoring all this other stuff. Who cares if your voice is perfect? Do you know that that one thing has kept me from singing at the prison? I used to sing there all the time. Had a wonderful time. The Holy Spirit showed up. We had news of that. But then I got caught up in this little bitty thing. How good did I sing? And I'm listening for myself. And I forget that it's not for you. I'm not trying to, oh, you sing good, girl. That's not the deal. You're supposed to be giving an offering to the Lord. And who cares who's playing the tambourine? Who cares who's making noise that's not perfect? It's supposed to be about you giving something to God. Who cares? Let them deal with what's going on with them. Get your nose out of somebody else's stuff and let God do what he needs to do. But when you get an attitude about, I don't like the music, I don't like how they did this, it's not how I did. We are not giving this heave offering to him. We're coming defiled before the Lord. And guess what? He doesn't receive a single thing that we've done. Well, how come, God, I don't get the blessing? Because you heaved up the wrong offering. Okay? Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. How much more time do I have? There's 38 pages so far, so I don't think you will stay for 3 days. So I just need to know all the time. I don't want to fix me. Okay, we need this one last scripture before we get to the offering of the red heifer, and we'll get into some deeper stuff with that. Ephesians chapter 5, here's part of the heave offering. Ephesians 5, 1 and 2. Imitate God. Can you see God getting upset because you got that? That belongs to me. Don't be talking to me. Okay. Imitate God. How would Jesus act? Therefore, in everything that you do, that means in your thought life, in the way that you act, everything that you do because you are his, dear children. Live a life filled with love. Guess what the hardest warfare in your life is? Walking in love. Because everybody else does it wrong, right? Live a life filled with love, following the example of Christ. He loved us and offered himself as a sacrifice for us, a pleasing aroma to God. And so we'll stop right here at the offering of the red heifer. So dang it, we didn't get as far as I wanted to, but we will get in here and we'll dig in some deep stuff, and I hope y'all enjoyed this, and I hope that it really meant something to you. But let me just pray over you, okay? Father, we come before you in the name of Jesus. And the more that we know about you, the more that we see that we really are unclean. So I'm asking you, clean these vessels. Make us usable. We offer up all the sin offerings, the blemishes, everything else that we're all messed up with. And we're asking you to come in and change us, cleanse us, make us who you want us to be. Remove whatever is unclean out of us, God, and get us to where we can come in the sheep gate after inspection, that we make it through into there, that we're not a goat rebelling against everything, talking smack. God, we want to be pleasing in what we say, whether it's out of gentleness, kindness, and love. So, Father, we can't do this. Like we saw in that movie last night, when that guy was running next to Jesus, he was running on water. But, God, we can't do it. We know that without you. You got to walk with us. You got to hold us. You got to hold our hand. You got to show us what to do. We give ourselves, Lord, as an offering. We want to sacrifice ourselves in this temple to you, saying that, God, you deserve it. You deserve the glory and the honor and the praise. You've made it so simple to get to heaven. So, Father, I pray that in Jesus' name, that as each person goes home, that, God, they will do that self-examination. And that they'll do what even the Torah said. Don't touch even the unclean thing. We want to be clean inside and outside. God, we're asking you to help us pass over this death. The enemy, he desires for us to be worldly. And God, we watch TV so much. It's a part of us. So we're asking you, God, change us. Take all those wrong things out of us so that we can be the kind of offering that would please you. So that when we pray, it really truly is a sweet savor, like incense to you. So that you fall in love with us because we are your children. We want to be the good kids. I want to go sit on Daddy's lap. So, Father, we ask you to do that for us in Jesus' name. Take us through that purification so that we can be who you called us to be. We ask you to remove all wickedness, anything that's defiled, in Jesus' name. Now, Father, we thank you that you're turning each one of us in the direction that we should go. Holy Spirit, you said that the only way we make it is if we walk with you hand in hand. So we're going to finish this race. We're going to complete the mission that the Lord has given us to do. We ask you to strengthen us, direct us, and as we sleep, download stuff into us, God, so that we can learn how to be perfectly cleansing. God, take us through the blood again so that, God, we could be clean. Wash us, God, so that we will be pure. We ask you to do that in Jesus' name. Amen. Did y'all enjoy the word tonight? It was good.